I'm not very sure that you can always separate private disputes from the public good. You take telecom. As a consumer, what is relevant to me is that there be a sufficient number of competent operators operating in a competitive environment. Whether these are A, B, C or X, Y, Z, I don't care. But it matters a hell of a lot to A, B, C and X, Y, Z who gets to provide that service. So how the license is granted, who gets a spectrum, is of material interest to a small number of would-be operators, but it is immaterial to the larger body of consumers who stand to gain from the service. So essentially, a private dispute between would-be operators can impact and destroy the telecom market, which is a public good. So the real issue is not whether the dispute is between private parties or between private parties in the public sector or within the public sector. That's not the issue. The issue is, do our policies and laws incorporate economic logic, and whether the Supreme Court should actually articulate that logic when it pronounces judgments. Now, as Swami said, the court came into the issue because the executive had failed to do its job. But then should the court's perspective be limited to the specific issue that has been raised? Or should that extend to the larger collective good? If the larger collective good guides the court into straying into areas which constitutionally are not its or its, then should it keep that larger collective good in firmly in view when it pronounces judgment? The biggest scam in coal is that it lies underground. India has the world's fifth largest reserves of coal. Today, power plants are running short of coal. We have 50,000 megawatt of installed generation capacity lying idle because there is no fuel. So the biggest scam in coal is that it lies underground. So should this worry the Supreme Court when it looks at the larger perspective? And how can you get this coal out if the state monopoly has failed to bring this out fast enough to meet the economy's demand? Then should private sector be employed? Now, again, another question is, which agents of the private sector should be selected to get this contract? That can be mired in controversy, there can be arbitrariness, there can be patronage, there can be corruption. Now, to answer the question, what can be done now about this coal allocation cancellation? To be fair to the Supreme Court, when it pronounced a judgment on the August 25th and declared that these are illegal, it said about these 40 producing mines, we understand if we cancel them, there could be consequences. And therefore, it gave the government a chance. And we'll have a separate hearing where we decide what to do with these producing mines. We do not want to outright cancel producing mines. It was on the government's assurance that you can go ahead, nothing will happen, we'll take care of it, that the court cancelled these licenses. To my mind, the court erred in trusting an executive that had proved to be unworthy of this trust in the first place, which necessitated the court to enter the picture, to remedy the problem effectively. The ordinance does not remedy this. The court has ordered that 295 rupees be levied as a penalty for every ton of coal that is in mine. This works out little over 10,000 crore worth of collective fines that the industry must pay. But because this industry has mined this coal, we have avoided so much import of equivalent amount of import of coal and lessened the pressure on the balance of payments. Because they mined this coal, we have produced power, steel, cement, aluminium, added to GDP, paid taxes. If these companies made excess profits, they paid tax on these profits. Will the government pay back these taxes? To my mind, what the government could have done, and perhaps still can do, is to retrospectively remove the technical illegality that the Supreme Court found. When there has been no malafide in the allocation of mines, but only the process was technically illegal, you remove that illegality retrospectively and regularize these producing mines or all those allocations for which there has been no malpractice. Going forward, forward, you auction the mines. This should have been the solution. Now, this cannot be mentioned openly in polite company except by journalists. So let me take that liberty and say this. If a Congress leader had not been one of the beneficiaries of these mines, it is possible that the government's attitude would have been different. DLF is another company that is perceived to be close to the Congress. It is facing a severe penalty for something which has caused no loss to any investor or any property owner, which is a technical nature, which could have been settled with a fine or a minor penalty, but now faces as severe a punishment as not being able to access the capital market, impeding the work of a company. Whether this is independent exercise of SEBI's powers or is it something to do with the proximity of this company to a political party opposed to the party in power, is for people to debate. Now, sometime back, some sugar companies filed a petition in the Supreme Court saying the entire process of liberalization undertaken since 1991 is illegal. The petitioner said the exceptions or exemptions provided in the law cannot overturn the larger purpose of the law. The Industrial Development Regulation Act was enacted to control industry, make them subject to government's licensing restrictions policies, and therefore any provision within that law to give an exemption for one or two instances cannot be used to liberalize the entire industry to overturn the purpose of the law. So he said, the liberalization that was done in 1991 was not done by scrapping the Industrial Development Regulation Act, but by making use of the exemption provision within the law, and therefore the entirety of the liberalization done, delicensing done, is illegal. Now, luckily, the Supreme Court chose not to accept this plea, although to my mind it is completely logical. So we have infirm laws on the basis of which we carry out policy. So this is open to interpretations which are socially, politically, economically informed or not informed. So I think we need to have better laws, we need to have better training of judges, and we need to have a procedure in which Supreme Court judges invariably reflect the wisdom of the Supreme Court itself in their pronouncements. To my mind, the Supreme Court's answer to the President's reference on natural resources completely undermines the logic on the basis of which the telecom license were cancelled. But since a court was not asked by anybody to apply this logic, the court did not. But should this happen? So I think the specific answer to the court problem is this. We should have denationalized coal in general and allow professional miners to come in and mine coal and give it to whoever wants it. Right now we have a situation where some steel companies have captive iron ore and captive coal. Some have only captive iron ore but no captive coal. And some have neither captive coal nor captive iron ore and have to compete with these same companies which have captive iron ore and captive coal. After this ordinance that has been passed, half-baked ordinance that it is, you can allocate coal to some companies, power producers, while you cannot, others have to compete without any captive coal. So you are creating a completely unequal playing field with judicial sanction through law and expecting the investors to come and invest in this kind of economy. I think this is ridiculously, patently ridiculous. And lawmakers, judges, courts, everybody has to address this.